deeper now into the Iranian election and what it means both inside Iran and for the rest of the world. To help with that, a panel extremely well-versed in the politics and diplomacy of Iran. Nicholas Burns is a professor of diplomacy and international politics at Harvard's Kennedy School, and he knows what he professes. He retired last year as this nation's highest-ranking career diplomat. Reza Aslan was born in Iran, now lives in Los Angeles, and is a writer and scholar. His latest book is How to Win a Cosmic War. Afshin Molavi is also a native Iranian. As a fellow at the New America Foundation, he studies democratization in the Middle East. Afshin, let me start with you. What is your reaction to not just the election, but the results?
Well, I think the results were surprising. I mean, the kind of numbers that we're hearing that Ahmadinejad has won, these are the kind of numbers that Mohammad Khatami, the reform-minded cleric, was getting. And so it is surprising that the Iranian population would go from a reform-minded cleric, give the same kind of numbers to this, you know, a populist sort of hardline figure.
Let's play that out. So
sure.
Whenever you had a high turnout in the past,
right.
It tended to, over the last 10 years at least, it helped the reformers.
Mm-hmm.
Ahmadinejad comes in and wins very narrowly in his first election, beats Rafsanjani, who was a kind of moderate establishment figure. And so what you're saying is, with a high turnout, to have had the pendulum swing so far in the opposite direction seems unlikely.
It does seem unlikely, and the Mousavi campaign feels it's unlikely. He's already called it a dangerous charade.
What does that tell us? Mousavi is willing openly to challenge the results, to defy the government?
Absolutely. I think what we're witnessing here, Fareed, is something when we take a deep dive, we're witnessing a generational rift here in Iran. Ahmadinejad represents the second generation of Iran's revolutionary elite who cut their teeth in the war with Iraq. Many of them come from security and intelligence backgrounds and the Revolutionary Guard. What he did in this campaign is he took aim at the old guard of the revolutionary elite, and he basically called them corrupt, fat cat insiders doing dirty business deals. Well, this is going to have ramifications beyond these elections that could spark a crisis of legitimacy.
And
within
these guys,
the Islamic Republic.
this old clerical elite, they're still in high positions of government.
Absolutely.
So these are not retired folks. He's talking about the Speaker of the Parliament. He's talking about the Chairman of the Assembly of Experts.
Absolutely. These are people who still wield considerable power. So I think what we're going to see now is this, you know, potential crisis play itself out. And Ahmadinejad has kind of set a bomb in the middle of the Islamic Republic of Iran, Inc., the business world of the clerics and their business counterparts.
The Iran of the 1980s doesn't really exist anymore. This notion that the mullahs are in charge is just simply not the whole story any longer. The power has become quite diffused into a whole host of competing poles of influence, one of which is increasingly becoming the executive branch. I mean, the one thing you can say about Ahmadinejad is that he's put an enormous amount of influence and power into what was essentially a powerless position. But the really fascinating thing is that now you have these new coalitions forming amongst centrists and pragmatists like Rafsanjani and more reformist groups like Khatami's followers, and they're trying to come together, put aside some of their ideological reservations, the old right and left argument that was so much about politics of the 1990s in Iran, and they're trying to push back against what they see as a militarization of Iranian politics. They are scared to death that Iran is becoming Egypt. That's what they're worried about.
Kind of a military dictatorship.
A country in which, behind the scenes, the military's in charge. That there is some sort of semblance of a government or an election, even sort of maintaining the oligarchy in place, but that the military is increasingly calling the shots. This is something that really scares the pants out of both the clerics and the reformists, which is why they're coming together now.
Nick, what does this election result mean for the United States?
Well, I think there's two aspects of this to look for. First is the United States is going to have to issue some kind of a statement decrying the election and the way it was held.
You would do that. You think that, I mean, you've been in the State Department. You think that's what they're discussing right now?
I think it's inevitable that the U.S. and other governments are going to have to comment on whether or not this election was free and fair. Now, we're not in a position to judge that. Certainly, we're not looking at it with any degree of authority, but the numbers don't add up. There's a suspicion of fraud in the elections. We know that the Interior Ministry was in charge of counting the ballots. We know the Interior Minister was an Ahmadinejad appointee and partisan. And it's going to be interesting to see what governments do, but I think they'll have to comment on the way the election was held. Secondly, and perhaps more importantly in terms of American interests, we're going to have to decide, what do we do now? Do we continue, the United States, Britain, France, the other countries, with the prospect of negotiations on the nuclear issue and other issues? I would say yes, you have to do that. But it makes it more difficult because Ahmadinejad is such an inflexible character and someone who has not shown any degree of willingness to meet the United States halfway. I mean, look, Fareed, you've had this extraordinary new and effective American president from the first minutes in his job, with the famous clenched fist reference to Iran in the inaugural speech, to the Nowruz message, to calling them by the name of the country, the Islamic Republic of Iran. He's made every effort to at least establish the basis of a first good conversation. We haven't had a single, haven't seen a single instance of Ahmadinejad doing the same. There's great disappointment in the United States and all over the world to see Ahmadinejad returned after four very difficult years.
And we will be back right after this.
They've got stadia.